Greater Vancouver is located on the mainland in the southwest corner of British Columbia, the westernmost of Canada's 10 provinces. In front is the ocean, behind are the snow-capped mountains, and in between, the bustling city is full of restaurants and cafes. It is utterly seductive. In 1858, following the Fraser River gold rush, fortune seekers flocked to the area, and a small settlement soon sprang up. This became known as Gastown. Not to be missed is the distinctive steam-powered clock, which starts chiming and hissing vapor every 15 minutes. Chinatown is only a handful of blocks away, a vibrant, frenetic tangle of streets packed with restaurants, markets and herb shops, and thousands of Chinese. Vancouver has the third largest Chinatown in North America, due to the fact that some 15,000 Chinese laborers were brought in from California after working on the Union Pacific Railway to work on the transcontinental rail line through the Fraser Valley. A metropolitan hub, the city of Vancouver is located on the Burrard Peninsula and borders the Pacific Ocean Inlet, the coast mountains, and the farmlands of the Fraser Valley. The Capilano Suspension Bridge is well worth a visit, the longest and the highest suspended footbridge in the world. It spans 137 meters across the Capilano River Canyon at a height of 70 meters. 800,000 visitors a year clutch their way across the dizzying heights of the bridge. Marilyn Monroe did it, Katharine Hepburn and the Rolling Stones did it, and Margaret Thatcher liked it so much, she did it twice. A few minutes away from the Capilano Bridge is the Sky Ride that takes visitors to the top of Grouse Mountain. The journey takes just 8 minutes, and each gondola has a 360-degree view of Greater Vancouver's spectacular scenery.
Relax and enjoy yourself as we take you on a journey to the top of Grouse Mountain, 3,700 feet or 1,100 meters above the city of Vancouver. For those of you skiing and snowboarding today, the present temperature is 2 degrees Celsius. We have a base of 204 centimeters of snow.
Here, visitors can ski, snowboard, or in better weather, hike or simply stroll and enjoy the magnificent view of Vancouver from the mountaintop. Snow seldom falls in the city, and yet Vancouver enjoys some of the best downhill and cross-country skiing in North America. On a clear evening, night skiing is particularly exhilarating, and the twinkling lights of the neighboring mountains can be seen in the distance. Grouse Mountain is one of the three such mountain resorts which overlook Vancouver, offering the discerning visitor tremendous summit views of the city skyline at night. Our journey aboard the Rocky Mountaineer begins at Vancouver's Pacific Central Station. Since its inaugural run in 1990, Rocky Mountaineer Rail Tours has become North America's largest privately owned rail tour operator. Passengers checking in are greeted by the proud and attentive Rocky Mountaineer staff. Over the next 2 days, we will travel over 600 miles, 1,000 kilometers, from Vancouver to Banff on what is said to be the most spectacular train trip in the world. After the traditional Rocky Mountaineer welcome, we board the train. Our journey is a special winter rail adventure, the Christmas Express. We will journey through uninhabitable and uncharted wilderness, vast and ever-changing scenery, and the spectacular Canadian Rocky Mountains. The attentive guest services team ensure that all the passengers are shown to their allocated seats to begin their journey. In keeping with the time of year, the guest service team are ready to spread the spirit of Christmas to their guests. As with all of the world-class luxury trains, this journey shows all the hallmarks of being one of the experiences of a lifetime. A journey by luxury rail, which will take us back in time and forwards through space. The first part of our journey will take us out of Vancouver through the Fraser Valley to our first destination, the town of Kamloops, where we will overnight. As the train pulls slowly out of Pacific Central Station, our journey begins, and we leave behind the awakening city of Vancouver. The passengers relax in the beautiful, spacious, air-conditioned, bi-level environment of the Dome coach.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'd just like to introduce myself. My name is J.J. Belanger. I'm the Director of Train and Station Services for the Great Canadian Rail Tour Company, proud owners and operators of this spectacular trip, the Rocky Mountaineer. As I stroll throughout the coach today, if you have any comments, questions, or concerns, feel free to ask. And again, we should have great running time through to Kamloops today, as we'll slowly be switching over to the CP track, and we'll be running with trains all the way through to Bass, and then we'll switch back over to CN. And we should have a clear shot, as they call it, straight into Kamloops. So we should be arriving into Kamloops around 4:30 p.m. And I'm not going to promise, but all things being normal, that's our arrival time. Again, welcome aboard, and look forward to seeing you throughout these spectacular 2 days.
As the first sitting for lunch begins, passengers are seated in the dining room on the lower level for the ultimate dining experience, with stunning and constantly changing scenery. Our journey takes us from the beauty of the coastal mountains through to the fertile farming lands of the Fraser River Valley and the historic gold rush route of the Fraser Canyon. The significance of the Fraser River, which is the major river to the province of British Columbia, to this trip, cannot go unnoticed. The Fraser River is almost 1,369 kilometers from its headwaters in the Rockies to its release into the Strait of Georgia near Vancouver. It was first navigated in 1808 by Simon Fraser, an explorer seeking a trade route to the Pacific Ocean. The river is also home to British Columbia's salmon runs. The Rocky Mountaineer carries its travelers back in time into the pages of Canada's rich history, and the land's legends are revealed. The canyon's most popular and renowned tourist attraction is Hell's Gate, the narrowest part of the Fraser River. Over 200 million gallons of water pound and surge each minute through a 34-meter wide gorge. The height of the Fraser can vary as much as 80 feet throughout the year at this point. Many visitors to Hell's Gate take in the excitement by riding the Swiss-built air tram, which descends 500 feet from the highway above to the other side of the gorge. Hell's Gate was named by Simon Fraser in 1808 because it reminded him of the gates of hell, stating at the time, "We had to pass where no human should venture." The exploration, surveying, construction and operation of the railways through the Rocky Mountains has generated an abundance of folklore. Most of it is true. Although some of the commonly told stories are fantastic in nature and difficult to believe, they reflect the reality of an exciting frontier where people and events often seemed larger than life. Prior to the railroad pioneers, the only human inhabitants were the native Indians, whose cultures were primarily supported by hunting and fishing.
Yeah.
The route from Boston Bar to Kamloops takes us along the walls of the narrow Fraser and Thompson River canyons. Running parallel on opposite sides of the canyons, the tracks of the Canadian Pacific and Canadian National Railroads follow the steep cliffs and cross the rivers several times. The Canadian National Line, our route of travel, was completed in 1915, 30 years after the Canadian Pacific Railroad. There wasn't room for two tracks on the same side of the river. Therefore, the Canadian National was forced to build their route on the more difficult side of the canyon. In the dining room, the second sitting of lunch is taking place. The menu on board the Rocky Mountaineer includes regional cuisine, which is created by talented onboard chefs. Comfort and the ultimate in service are provided by well-trained staff. All meals are served with a friendly smile. Continuing our journey towards Kamloops, we pass through Boston Bar. The gold rush in the 1850s attracted miners from many places, and settlements such as Boston Bar were named after the hometowns of these miners who panned for gold on many sandbars of the Fraser River. After lunch, passengers can retire to the club car, one of two multifunction cars on board. Live entertainment is provided at regular intervals throughout the journey, and here passengers can enjoy a drink from the well-stocked bar. On our journey, we cross the Fraser River twice and the Thompson River seven times. It is now late afternoon, and as we continue towards Kamloops, the sun begins to set. Thank you. We arrive at our overnight destination of Kamloops and are greeted by Mounties. Derived from the Shuswap Indian word Kamloops, Kamloops means meeting of the waters and refers to the junction of the North and South Thompson Rivers. The Shuswaps were the first inhabitants of Kamloops, being an offspring of the Salish Indian nation. Although Kamloops today has a population of only 82,000 inhabitants, the city spans over an area greater than that of New York City. It is here that the Rocky Mountaineer will lay over, and the passengers will spend the night in a local hotel. We have traveled on the first day since leaving Vancouver a distance of over 400 kilometers. For dinner that evening, all passengers are taken to the Two Rivers Junction for a musical review about the legendary train robber, Billy Miner. The story of Billy Miner is one full of stagecoach and train robberies, over 35 years of prison and various prison breaks. They put on masks and they became the Miner Bunch. The Miner Bunch, the Miner Bunch, the Miner Bunch, the Miner Bunch. They put on masks and became the Miner Bunch. Billy Miner was taken to jail in Kamloops following his capture after a train robbery that didn't go to plan. When a train was rescheduled and Billy and partner robbed the wrong train, they ended up with just $15 and a handful of liver pills. It's early morning on day two of our journey, and the passengers are once again boarding the train for the second part of this trans-mountain journey. The Rocky Mountaineer runs two separate routes out of Kamloops, when during the summer tours, the train splits with one half going to the town of Jasper and the other continuing on to Banff and finally Calgary. It has been snowing during the night.
We're on our way. How's that? A few minutes early. It started snowing about 90 minutes ago, which was right on schedule. We ordered this as part of your winter experience. Just a couple moments and we will get our services underway. As promised yesterday, those of you that were on second seating yesterday, you know, first seating today, it'll just be a matter of moments and we'll get things underway. Please sit back, relax, enjoy your day.
Day two of the journey begins as the train departs Kamloops en route for Banff. The station staff are out on the platform to see the Rocky Mountaineer off on the next stage of the adventure. Whilst the passengers are served breakfast, the train continues in a northeasterly direction, leaving behind Kamloops. The first part of today's journey takes us along the Canadian Pacific tracks, passing by the Shuswap Lakes, the historic site of Craigellachie, and on to Revelstoke, nestled in the Columbia Valley. Between Kamloops and Revelstoke, you cannot help but notice the contrast between the sparsely treed and sagebrush-covered South Thompson River Valley and the densely forested Columbia Mountain region. An area well known for its sparkling lakes and rivers. The Shuswap Lakes contain almost 1,000 miles of shoreline, and it is a favorite vacation spot for visitors during the summer months. Fishing, boating, and other water sports are very popular in this area. Lake trout, Dolly Varden, rainbow trout, and kokanee are the most common game fish in the surrounding lakes, whereas the Thompson and Adams River systems are well known for sockeye, coho, and spring salmon. Continuing our journey into the historic section of the trip, we pass by the spot where Billy Miner's last train robbery took place. Shortly after the infamous robbery, Billy Miner and his gang were captured by the Royal Canadian Mounted Police and taken to the prison in Kamloops. Scattered throughout this region are strange rock and clay formations called hoodoos. These were formed after the end of the last ice age. James Terry is the senior vice president and operations manager of the Rocky Mountaineer Rail Tours.
One of the things that's really the secret of what we do and the whole experience is that it is a two-day experience. And we once had our vice president of marketing and sales was introducing a new potential client to the train, and was going to show him the train when it arrived in Vancouver Station. And before he even got on the train, he said, that's it, I'm buying into this, this is wonderful. And Murray, our vice president of marketing and sales, looked at him and said, why, you haven't seen it yet? And he said, I've seen the attitude of the guests coming off the train, and they're all hugging the onboards and everything. And a lot of that happens, and we're now talking to you on day two of this trip, is that there's this wonderful day one, and everybody gets to know each other slowly and understand what life is like on the train, and then everybody gets off in Kamloops and stays in hotels. And by the time you re-meet and re-greet your onboard for the second day, there's a tremendous sort of bonding that starts, and by the end of the 2 days, it's an excellent experience.
The Rocky Mountaineer also carries an onboard entertainer to keep the children amused during the journey.
You can do a dragon? You want to do a dragon? We need a clean piece of paper. Oh, there's a clean piece of paper. A dragon, they have wings, don't they?
Don't do that.
Want me to do it? Okay, on the back part? Okay. Now, dragons, they blow fire, don't they? They have two big eyeballs.
We are by now approaching Craigellachie, an important point in the history of Canadian railways. Craigellachie is the place where the last spike of the Canadian Pacific Railroad line was driven in 1885. This historic commemoration was carried out by Donald Smith, who was one of the original syndicate members who founded the Canadian Pacific Railroad. A cairn now marks the spot of this historic event, which linked Canada by rail from ocean to ocean. The spike marked the realization of a dream. William Van Horn, president of the Canadian Pacific Railroad from 1888 until 1899, was a man who strongly believed in the importance of rail travel. In 1881, after a successful railway career in the United States, he joined the Canadian Pacific Railroad as their general manager. His job was to build Canada's transcontinental railway across almost 5,000 kilometers of rugged terrain. Through his determined efforts, this dream was finally realized when the last spike joining the east and west was finally driven in. Van Horn was also a strong believer in tourism and loved the beauty of the Canadian Rockies. He once stated, "If we cannot export the scenery, we'll import the tourists." Since that time, visitors from around the world have followed his advice and experienced the pleasures of Canadian train travel. Though they have marveled at the vast, ever-changing scenery, the part they most vividly remember is the spectacular journey through the Canadian Rocky Mountains. The Rocky Mountaineer is without doubt the finest way to be transported on that journey. For, in the words of the owners, this is not just a train, but also a wonderful experience.
Thank you.
We are now approaching the remote town of Revelstoke. Revelstoke was named after Lord Revelstoke, an Englishman whose bank was responsible for much of the funding of the Canadian Pacific Railroad in the late 1880s. It is now a strategic point in the railway network, not so much for the few passenger trains which pass through, but more for the enormous freight trains. During the boom years of the 1920s and through the tough economic depression of the 1930s, both the Canadian Pacific Railroad and Canadian National Railroad consolidated their positions as national rail networks and transportation conglomerates. In Western Canada, the railways serviced and helped develop natural resources. Freight trains moved grain, lumber, pulp and paper, coal, potash, sulfur, copper, petrochemicals, and a host of other industrial commodities. This was the business that ultimately justified the insanity of building these ribbons of steel through the Rockies. Hauling such cargo is how the railway earned their income. Today, these trains run with 4 or 5 locomotives pulling up to 150 or more freight cars, running over 2 kilometers in length. There are currently plans to introduce freight trains which are in excess of double this. During the course of a busy life, the opportunity to unwind and travel on a truly magnificent train ride is an all too rare experience. It is important to remember that the word travel comes from the French word travail, to work, and it is only in the last century or so that people have actually traveled for pleasure. Prior to that, traveling across continents was hard and dangerous work, and very few contemplated setting out on a real journey. Such adventures were reserved for those hardy or driven souls intent on pursuing trade, pilgrimages, or war. However, by the 19th century, the Industrial Revolution transformed both attitudes and ability to travel, and the single most important development was the invention and application of the locomotive. Soon, the romance of rail travel encircled the globe. Travelling on trains such as this, you are captivated by the world rolling by. You can see so much more from a train than other forms of travel, and nothing else gives you a sense of covering distance, of kilometres passing beneath the wheels. And as the great 20th century rail traveller Paul Terreau wrote, almost anything is possible on a train. This part of our journey, we follow 3 different waterways, the Île Silhouette, the Columbia, and the Kicking Horse. We travel some 126 miles on this part of our trip between the Selkirk and the Rocky Mountains. One of the most spectacular sights on our journey is the Stony Creek Bridge.
So once again, just looking forward and to the right. As we go over this bridge, you'll appreciate the difficulties of having to build the same bridge 3 times, and making sure there is very little room in the area, so they had to use the same foundation. Effectively, the 3rd bridge was built over the 2nd bridge while the 2nd bridge was still in use. So they were building and the freight trains were coming underneath them as the trains were running. So if we look forward now to the right-hand side, you can see this arch coming up. That is the arch of the Stony Creek Bridge. This is an excellent point to be taking pictures. It's quite a quick photographic moment. The next time we see it, you'll be able to see it with the train actually going over. There's the train there. front locomotive. Mm-hmm. Now, there's several things you can do if you're afraid of heights. I do suggest, and it does happen once in a while, so I bring it up, look up at the trees or up at the sky. We're going to be going... just going up over the riverbed, but it's going to see a very, very large drop because the side of the mountain itself is falling away at a very steep incline. And so it's going to be quite spectacular as we go over. We'll be able to look down over the Beaver Valley beneath us. There's the Trans-Canada Highway just on the far side of the Beaver Valley. And then once we are in about the middle of the bridge on the left-hand side, we're going to be able to see a waterfall coming down off of Mount Tupper. Waterfall should have produced some beautiful icicles of itself just coming off the rocks. For those of you who are a bit daredevil, I challenge you to watch the ground drop away and see just how quickly it happens. And then on the other side, see just how quickly it comes back up.
Located on the eastern slopes of Mount Tupper, the Stony Creek Bridge's architectural design and beauty make it one of the world's most important bridges of its time. The bridge spans almost 150 meters and towers 100 meters above the creek bed. Originally, a wooden structure spanned the canyon, but this was replaced by 1893 as it had become a fire hazard. The new bridge, constructed of steel, was arch-shaped and measured over 100 meters long. By 1929, the weight of the locomotives had almost doubled, and Canadian Pacific Railroad was forced to replace this structure. Because of the terrain around the bridge, no other foundation could be found. Therefore, this current bridge had to be built right over the old one without placing any pressure on it. This part of our journey from Revelstoke to Field is one full of history, tunnels, bridges and snow sheds. The Rogers Pass is a very beautiful and interesting part of the journey. The first railway line was laid in 1885. It looped back and forth along the sides of the mountains, crossed creeks and ravines on enormous wooden trestles. Between 1885 and 1911, the deaths caused by avalanches totaled over 200. The snow was such an impediment to safe rail travel, the Canadian Pacific Railroad was forced to build a 5-mile-long underground tunnel through which we travel. This is the small town of Field, so named after an American promoter, Cyrus Westfield, who visited in 1884. The train will shortly arrive at Field Station and stop briefly for a change of locomotive driver. In 1886, the railway built a log station and Mount Stephen House. A hotel was used as a meal station for transcontinental trains. The hotel was built from funds received from a grant from Cyrus Field and existed until 1954. Snow has always been the railway's biggest enemy, and this stretch of track is possibly the most hazardous. In the Canadian Pacific Railroad's first few years of operation, extremely heavy snowfalls prevented all-year travel through the mountains. The route chosen by Major A. Rogers, the pass through which we have already traveled bearing his name, is witness to some of the deepest recorded snowfall in the world. An often told story is about an engineer who lost a 40-ton snowplow complete with crew. It was later found buried in a snowdrift. When this section of the track was constructed, the workers had to contend with face-biting blizzards and temperatures dropping as low as 40 degrees below zero. In order to haul a 15-car train up the big hill preceding Field, four huge 150-ton locomotives were required, two in front and two behind. Even then, wheels spinning on slippery tracks often caused the trains to stall. Their steam whistles would echo through the mountainside, calling for assistance of another pusher to help it over the crest of the hill. Some locomotives even exploded under the stress. All this, however, soon became routine. Regardless of weather conditions, the brakeman would get off and walk alongside the train, watching for signs of overheating brakes or skidding wheels. Switchmen waited at the safety switches. If the engineer's speed was prescribed at 6 miles per hour or less, he was allowed to continue down the hill. When the train went out of control, however, there was nothing to do but switch it into one of the three safety spurs, where, as one old railroader put it, wrecks could take place without hindering traffic on the main line. One engineer won the dubious honor of riding one of these runaway engines all the way down the big hill without signaling the switchman to change lines. When he finally brought the engine to a halt at field, he briefly enjoyed his celebrity of being the only engineer to ride a runaway engine the length of the big hill. Field to Banff, the final part of our unique journey. We will travel through the spiral tunnels built through Mount Ogden and Cathedral Mountain and see the majestic Canadian Rockies. In keeping with this being a special Christmas trip, the Rocky Mountaineer also had a special guest to delight the children. Departing Field Station for the final leg of our journey, we witness even more spectacular scenery. This area is home to the Stoney Indian tribe. The Stoney Indians were named for their method of cooking by boiling with hot stones. They moved eastward from the wooded regions of Manitoba as the flood of settlers and the railroad moved westward. Fleeing and fighting smallpox and other tribes along their journey, they finally settled in the foothills and mountains at the western edge of the prairie. Today, as we pass through their territory, they earn their living from horse ranching and royalties from natural gas that was discovered below their lands. To eradicate the problems of traveling across the Big Hill, two mammoth tunnels were designed. In 1907, the construction began on the unique spiral tunnels. They were based on the Bechina Gorge tunnels in Switzerland. It took 1,000 men 20 months to complete and involved the excavation of 750,000 cubic yards of rock and cost over $1 million to build. However, in doing so, they managed to reduce the grade from a dangerous 4.5 to a more manageable 2.2%. The lower spiral is tunneled through Mount Ogden and is approximately 1 kilometer long, turning approximately 230 degrees, the exit emerging 17 meters higher than its entrance. The upper spiral travels through Cathedral Mountain. This is another 100 meters longer than the lower one and turns approximately 250 degrees, its exit emerging 15 meters higher than its entrance. The whole construction forms a perfect maze and is one of the world's great feats in railway engineering. Winding through the mountains, the railway doubles back upon itself twice. Tunneling through the massive rock formation, it also crosses the river twice in order to cut down the steep gradient. It is often possible to watch a freight train leaving one of the tunnels, whilst another kilometre of rear freight cars are still pulling into the entrance. Thus, the Big Hill, the weak link in the Canadian Pacific Railroad, was finally tamed. We're approaching Banff. The mountain peaks of Castle Mountain tower above the backdrop. At almost 3,000 meters, this bulky, turreted mountain is an excellent example of castellated type mountains, ones that have horizontal rock layers. It was named by one Dr. James Hector in 1858 for its castle-like shape. In 1945, Prime Minister Mackenzie King renamed the mountain in honor of the General of World War II Allied Forces, Dwight D. Eisenhower. In 1979, the original name was reinstated by the federal government, but the first tower of the mountain retains the name Eisenhower Peak. Crossing over mountain passes that were first crossed by travelers of another era, the romance of train travel combined with the majestic beauty of the towering mountains has not lost its appeal. We are finally pulling into the station of Banff, the famous spa and ski resort, and the end of the line for many of the passengers, although some will continue on for another 4 hours into Calgary. This has been a wondrous journey through a country steeped in natural beauty. A century and a half ago, British railway pioneers unleashed a new technology that promised to change the world. Canada was one of the dreams delivered by the railway age. Perhaps that fact alone helps to explain the country's continuing love affair with trains, and in particular, our own newfound love affair with this, the Rocky Mountaineer, the train which hauled us on one of the most spectacular train journeys in the world.